Good morning, once again. Thank you for joining us here on Rush Hour. You're in time for the big issue. My name is Lynn Komjisha. Now, we are into the second and the last week of the conference of parties, or the United Nations Climate Change Conference going on in Egypt, the COP27, and the strong messages of ringing out from parties accusing each other of violating the Paris Agreement and subsequent international treaties on climate, but also on climate financing and adaptation. Those are the conversations that have been taking place so far. We have a Ugandan delegation there represented by the Environment Energy Ministers at the conference that is going on in Egypt. Joining me this morning to talk about that and so much more. And remember, the president recently wrote a very elaborate letter, and he was making, he says that Museveni was making a mockery of the West's climate targets. And if you read that letter, or if you read that commentary, he was accusing Western countries of hypocrisy over commitments to stop climate change. We're going to have that discussion in a bit with Susan Nandudu, a climate journalist and activist, and also Natif Bob, Assistant Commissioner in the Ministry of Water, Land, Environment and Climate Change. Very good morning, Susan Nandudu. Bring us up to speed. What is going on at the COP27 in Egypt? How are things so far? We are in the second and last week of the conference. What has so far been covered, and what's the mood like?
Thank you so much for having me. I need to clarify, first of all, that I am not a commissioner in the ministry.
I was referring to another guest that we have.
Okay. Great. So thank you for hosting this session. So the conference of the parties is taking shape, like you have rightly said. This year, this week is the second segment of the negotiations. The first week had the technical elements, and I must add that a lot is being negotiated. We have the tracks of mitigation, which probably has a bearing on what the president said. We have a track on adaptation, we have a track on loss and damage, which very, very fortunately this year got onto the agenda. It had been part of advocacy from the Global South for many years. We have climate finance, we have gender, we have technology transfer, capacity building, among other things. So when we speak about what is happening at the COP, you may want our listeners to know that there are both negotiations that are happening inside negotiating rooms where our governments, or the governments of 198 countries, meet to speak around those elements that I've talked about, but they are also on the sidelines, which is happening in a vast way. So much happening is side events. There are so many side events that are showcasing what is going on around the world in terms of action related to climate change. So governments, civil society organizations, private sector, many of them are showcasing through workshops and also demonstrating what they are doing on the ground. And on the other side, civil society is also demanding, putting out demands through demonstrations for better outcomes from the negotiations. What I can say, go ahead.
No, sure. I was going to ask you about climate financing, which is the most important discussion at the COP. Many African countries, or should we say least developed countries, are calling for climate financing because they are the recipients of the effects of the biggest challenges of climate change. How is that conversation going?
Thank you for that question. Let's do a bit of history here.
Right.
We know that the impacts of climate change that we are experiencing today are a result of the emissions that, the emissions of more than two decades ago. And the developed countries also agree that they are responsible for that. The industrialization of two centuries ago have brought us where we are. So we are witnessing the flooding, we are witnessing the droughts, which are normal natural phenomena, but it is the frequency that is happening at a higher rate and the intensity that is impacting us negatively. So you may be aware that some decades ago, our farmers used to not have a problem with their farming. No one was saying to Saba government yet Yambe, because they could grow their food and their food would yield enough and life would go on. Mm. Now, that is becoming increasingly difficult in a world where the droughts are happening almost every year, or the floods. And there are communities like in Bududa area that are also having landslides. So it is against that premise that negotiations many years ago arrived at a decision that the developed countries have a responsibility to support developing countries that have contributed the least, to this problem with financing. Now, back in 2009, during COP15, we are in COP27,
yes.
The developed countries made a pledge that they would deliver. They would deliver $100 billion mm-hmm. annually. So every year, the expectation was that they would all mobilize $100 billion, make it available for us in the Global South to access so as to invest in what is going to help us prepare better for the future and current impacts of climate change.
Right.
How are they faring on that goal? The most recent statistics that we have are of 2020, and they show that even in 2020, they failed to meet the 100 billion goal. At least by 17 billion US dollars. Mm-hmm. Now, in the negotiations, the issue at hand, there are several issues, but one of them is that in addition to that $100 billion per year, we would like to see a new goal, a more ambitious goal, to keep up with the pace of the impacts that we are facing and the need for countries to mitigate and adapt to impacts of climate change.
Right.
So this year, we were expecting that we would have a new and more ambitious goal. That is not happening. The negotiations so far are showing that the developed countries are not eager to move in that direction.
Mm.
The second element that we in the Global South are very, very interested in is having a proper definition of climate finance. What does it actually mean? How different is it from official development assistance? And our argument is that climate finance should be new and additional to ODA, Official Development Assistance. But our friends in the Global North do not agree. They want anything and everything to be called climate finance. And that defeats the purpose of the whole idea of climate finance. So one of the things that we were hoping this year would come up with is a definition that all of us agree to, and
Susan, I think we're losing you. But we're talking about the COP27 that's going on in Egypt, and Susan was bringing us up to speed on the negotiations in regard to climate financing, climate change financing, that has been a global conversation world over. Now, if I could maybe put it straight, climate financing as part of the United Nations encompasses financial resources and sound investments that are needed to address climate change, to both reduce emissions, promote adaptation to the impacts that are already occurring, and to build resilience. How are we going to rebuild resilience? You and I need to have that conversation. But now, from what Susan has so far told us, it is unlikely that wealthy nations, the global north, will make any move on loss and damage finance. Most of them are saying they are not agreeing to this request or to this. You know, they signed 13 years ago to make available funds to mitigate the issues that come with climate change. Susan, are you back? Susan, can you? Oh, yes, perfect. There we have. Now, Susan, since most of the global north are not agreeing to what they signed 13 years ago and are really failing to meet that ambitious target that you'd hoped to, you know, meet or set this time around in the COP27, let's talk about climate adaptation. Climate change adaptation. We're trying to adapt to, you know, the climate change and how we can, you know, come around the issues or the challenges that climate change has created. First of all, why is adaptation important and how are we doing so far? Susan?
So for us, as a country, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, yes. Go on, please.
Oh, dear.
I'm saying go on, Susan, we can hear you. Okay. I think we're having a network problem there, but we want to look at climate change, the issues that bring that climate change has, you know, caused globally. But then there's also an interesting report recently that says the V20, that is the vulnerable countries, facing the worst climate impacts and have lost over $500 billion US dollars from destructive climate events in the last two decades. And Uganda is no exception. We have seen the climate change phenomenon that we have been experiencing. In the absence of loss and damage support, these populations now face a tax on their development, existence, and dignity as climate impacts escalate and compounds indebtedness and fair trading regimes and limited access to capital. So we want to talk climate change adaptation. Why does it matter? And this is what I was trying to, you know, hear from Susan, who is on ground in Egypt in Sharm el-Sheikh, in Egypt, trying to, you know, have on the grounds of the COP27 that is going on in Egypt. So when Susan gets back, we want to understand the issue of climate change adaptation. Adaptation means we are working around the issues, the challenges that climate change is bringing forward. And if we are to adapt to any things around that, it means we are adopting ways of living with the challenges of, you know, climate change. But again, recently, the president of Uganda, His Excellency President Yoweri Museveni, lashed out at the West, calling European countries hypocrites over their commitments to end climate change effects. If you remember, there was a contention over an EU Parliament resolution against the ECOP, and recently we are seeing that in Germany, the Europeans are trying to, you know, reheat their coal pipelines. And I think, Susan, are you back? Can you hear me well?
I can.
Yes, perfect. So we're talking about the issue of climate change adaptation. What measures lie around adaptation, and why does it matter?
Again, apologies for the network here. Adaptation for us is the most important response measure to climate change, and it is mostly because we are a poor country, we are vulnerable. And let me try to explain that. Unlike our developed country parties that have established systems, they have options to run to should a disaster happen. If there is a massive flood in the US, there will be quick response that will, first of all, inform the people that a flood is coming. Prepare, perhaps get out. Secondly, they will rescue anyone that is affected. Thirdly, they will put them in a place where they will feed them, protect them until they are able to go back.
That's right.
Look now back at us. How is that happening? Actually, a flood or a drought happens unannounced. Most people do not know it is coming. And the devastation that happens mostly is taken on by the people themselves. Now, our limits, our capacity to deal with these impacts is very, very small, individually, but also collectively as a country. So adaptation basically means that you are responding to the current impacts of climate change. You are supporting the people to understand the magnitude of the problem,
right,
and they are investing in what is needed to help them keep them in a buffer should an extreme event, a hazard happen or not. And I'll put that in context. We are a farming country, and most of our people depend on agriculture and for a livelihood, for income, etc. Now, when the agriculture is affected, when a farmer is not able to yield from their sweat, what do they do? Lately, we are hearing a lot of Tusaba government etiyambe, but we are also seeing those who are not coming out to say we need help. They are dying. People died in Karamoja because of food insecurity. So adaptation is a priority to us from that context, but also from the context that we have contributed the least to the greenhouse gas emissions. The developed world, their priority is that they must cut down on the emissions, which historically and traditionally they are contributing the largest to. So that is why adaptation is very important. Now, to get it in action, as a farmer, you need, for example, to invest in irrigation technology. I am here in Sharm El Sheikh. It is a desert, and anything green that you see, any flower, any tree, you know that it is watered by irrigation. It is not rain, but it is irrigation now. I've looked at the investment that people put in just to have a compound. And you know, it is so different a world. In our country, we cannot even afford to invest in irrigation technology. So in the negotiations, we are calling on availability of finance to enable us as least developed countries, as vulnerable countries, as vulnerable communities, to be able to invest in technologies such as this, to invest in capacity building that can help us to prepare better. And this, it is also a sticky area in the negotiations, particularly around the issue of financing. From the statistics I shared earlier, of the 83.3 billion made available in 2020, only 34% of that went to adaptation. Yet a decision through the negotiation already came through saying that 50% of climate finance needs to go to adaptation and 50% to mitigation. But most of the money is going to mitigation and it is going through loans. For adaptation, we are saying money should come and flow through grants, mostly grants. But again, the developed countries do not agree. So there are sticky areas there. And I would like to introduce a very, very important issue for the people in the Global South. We are experiencing losses and damages. The recent science of climate change by the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has also introduced that language that now losses and damages associated to climate change are on the increase. And the negotiation or the lobbying has been that we have an agenda item to speak to loss and damage. This November, the beginning, it was introduced on the agenda, so we celebrated that that was a win. However, again, it is another slow area because another interest that we have is to introduce a loss and damage finance mechanism. Now, the developed countries still are not interested in moving in that direction. They would like to put in place measures, mechanisms, procedures, etc., but not speak to the issue of loss and damage financing at the moment.
Absolutely. Susan, now you already alluded to the fact that high-income countries have the means to bounce back from the hottest summers, unprecedented outbreaks of wildfires and the like. But the most vulnerable, which are the least responsible for this crisis, do not. Now, the stark reality is why COP27's legacy must at least be on adaptation and loss and damage finance for countries already being walloped by escalating impacts. And now you already said that the global north is failing to come to terms to adaptation and loss and damage financing. Let's come back a little bit back to Uganda. Do we, for example, have any policies in place? For example, in regard to national adaptation plans, have we set out to, you know, find solutions, our own adaptation measures, while we wait for the global north to, you know, come forward?
Absolutely. Our government has, I think, for the last 10 to 13 years, been involved in policy making. A lot of policies have come out as a result. We have a national climate change policy. It speaks to all the areas that where we need intervention around climate change, including mitigation and adaptation. We have a new kid on the block, the Climate Change Act of 2021.
Yes.
The regulations are not yet out. They are, I think, being developed. We have an instrument that we pass on to the Global North, to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, called the Nationally Determined Contributions. In that document, we specify to the world that here are our contributions. This is what we are going to do to address impacts of climate change as a country. We have a policy on human, on capacity building. We have a policy on human resources. So I think for me, in terms of policies, we have advanced quite a lot. Yes, you talked about the national adaptation plans. While we do not have an aggregate plan for all sectors for the country, some sectors like agriculture have moved ahead to develop their own national plan on adaptation. Now, sorry, the sector plan on adaptation. What is the issue around these policies? It is again another disease that we have in our country, that implementation is slow. The pace at which we are implementing these policies is much slower than is needed. However, that does not take away the fact that there is action going on. I know for sure that we have received financing that is called tagged climate finance through different sources. For example, the UNDP, the UNFAO. There are projects that are ongoing, that are testing, that are applying solutions for adaptation and mitigation in our country. So for me, what is needed, one, we need to build visibility of what is being done and what lessons are we learning from there, so that the rest of the country should learn from that. I think the media is a great platform to share these lessons and interesting yourselves in what is being done would help us and our people as a country. But on the flip side is that we need to do a lot more to attract more financing to help us implement our policies. Now, from the our nationally determined contributions, it clearly states that 80% of the financing that is required to implement what we need as a country should come from external sources.
Absolutely.
So only 20% is supposed to be mobilized locally.
Yes.
Now, how do we know how much we are mobilizing locally and how much is being mobilized globally? That is an issue that we need to address.
Absolutely.
Back home. And how effective are we with what is being mobilized? Equally
Susan,
is important.
Susan, while we refer to all these policies that we have on climate change and the climate policies, climate change policies, are these policies really looking at mainstreaming climate, mainstreaming of climate change adaptation into national and sectoral policies, projects and plans, and also making sure that they tally with the economic and social realities of our country, Uganda?
Thank you for that. I think the law has now made it a requirement. I don't think many ministries, departments, agencies, NGOs, and other stakeholders have looked at this law, but It is very categoric in defining the institutional framework. And in the institutional framework, we are all responsible to act on climate change. And we have a responsibility to equally report on what is being done.
Absolutely.
So as the regulations are expounded, I believe that it will become clearer, but there is need for awareness raising about what the law requires and therefore what each institution needs to do, including the media, to get on to the fight to address climate change.
Right, Susan, now away from climate adaptation and financing, we understand also the conversation on fossil fuels has been really high on agenda on the COP27. Recently, the President Museveni, in his opinion recently, he wrote that he actually lashed out at the West for calling them the West European countries, especially calling them hypocrites over their commitments to end climate change effects. Now he said it is unacceptable for the West to advocate against fossil fuel investment in Africa while Europe is investing in its own. The conversation around fossil fuels, how has that gone at COP27, and what are your comments on President Museveni's opinion?
Interesting. So for starters, I do not follow closely the issue of mitigation, but I can put a comment around that. So what is going on around the issue of mitigation? This year, the main focus is to expound on Article 6 of the Paris Agreement, and this speaks about the carbon markets. And these are voluntary mechanisms for mitigation where countries have allowed to, you know, participate in carbon markets as one, a way of attracting financing, but also to raise the ambition and action around mitigation.
Right.
The negotiations around this have come up with something good. As of yesterday, there was a report that there is agreement on the issue of transparency, where both the developed and the developing countries agree that we each need to report, be transparent about what we are doing and the emission reduction. So that has not been a sticky issue. There are issues around response measures, around the global stocktake, where developed countries are supposed to account in terms of mitigation actions. There is no conclusion around that. On the issue of carbon markets, they have been discussing elements around the infrastructure processes, but also how to conduct the carbon markets.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Africa especially is lagging behind around this element, and I have understood that we have a lot of potential to attract financing through private sector in the carbon markets, but we lag behind because we are not able to design bankable projects, but perhaps the understanding around the issue is very, very low. I was part of a side event yesterday that spoke to the issue of carbon markets, and a recent research from West Africa showed that the public sector that does engage in carbon markets, the environment, the providing a conducive legal and policy framework, their understanding of the issues is still low. I equally agree. I am among those whose understanding is low. And we need to work on that and address it. On the question of the president's comment. Now, that is also a historical element that has to be considered.
Mm.
So, can I continue?
Yeah,
will you say something?
No, please proceed.
Okay. So, in the convention of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, there is a principle of common but differentiated responsibilities, which ideally allows that the response to climate change has to take or bear in mind the different capabilities
mm-hmm.
of the different countries. And in terms of the fossil fuels and extracting our oil, we are, as developing countries, are still allowed a quota to do that, especially from the point of view that it is going to bring about development from our countries.
Yes.
And The issue around that is that we have to ensure that, unlike the developed world, we take care, we safeguard the environment, and social safeguards are all embedded. Mm-hmm. Now, the science is no longer agreeing with that. The science is saying that we have to keep all fossil fuels in the ground. And the practice is also suggesting that there are alternatives where investments should go, and renewable energy investments are even cheaper in terms of, the investment in renewable energy is becoming cheaper. But we have not been able to follow that track yet. So we are at the moment, as a country, but also as a continent in Africa, one of the most energy poor countries, in addition to being a least developed country. So when the president says that the developed countries are hypocrites, he is referring to the fact that the EU Parliament came out to say that we go slow on the extraction of our oil, yet the EU itself is already investing in opening up new areas of oil drilling, of coal. So the hypocrisy there is that they are not walking the talk. If you are the largest, you are part of the largest emitters, and you are still drilling oil, you are still extracting fossil fuels, why do you want to stop the others that have not even contributed at all in that direction? So this is a very sticky issue, a very contentious issue, and it has to be looked at in very many perspectives, including development. For me as a person, I am open to us having this resource extracted, provided that it delivers the development that we are looking for. If we are able to be transparent and utilize the resource to build the systems that we need, to invest in infrastructure, to invest in early warning systems, in irrigation technology that can buffer our people from the excessive impacts of climate change tomorrow, that would be a good investment. But if this resource is going to go into people's pockets, as we have seen from our traditional experience as a country, then there's a problem there.
Absolutely. Susan, now, the president actually was arguing that Africans want to use their own fossil fuel resources to develop their countries, bring electricity to the households, provide jobs, and move people out of poverty. And Europe, however, has agreed with the United States and Canada not to finance fossil fuel projects in Africa. Yet Europe wants to buy African oil and natural gas for its own use. So I think that's the hypocrisy I was also talking about, which you've already alluded to. But coming back to the issue of these countries talking about losses and damages, and they do not want to be part and, you know, to expose themselves to the liability claims in regard to climate change financing. As we get into the last round of our conversation, we are saying that these global south countries or the least developed countries surely need a lot of money to mitigate the effects of climate change. And that seems not to be the issue. We're not seeing progress in these conversations or in these negotiations that is going on in Egypt. How do we move forward from all that?
I mean, that is the real issue that we have to face, and two things, two reflections on my side around that is, for the last 27 COPs,
Yes.
We have been seeing this happen over and over, progress, especially to the interests of those in the global south, is slow. But slow doesn't mean we don't achieve anything. And so for me, what are we doing with what we are, what is being achieved out of this is very, very critical. Now, our negotiators have the responsibility to ensure that our interests are taken care of. When that negotiations end, it's no longer the responsibility of the negotiators. It is the responsibility of other stakeholders, perhaps those listening to this conversation, yes, to take it forward. Of the $83 billion that was made available in 2020, how much came to Uganda? Why did very little, for example, come to Uganda, if at all it did? So I think that we need to become more aggressive in tapping into the opportunities that come out of the negotiations. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, our government is pursuing some bilaterals, as many others. There are conversations happening on a one-on-one with the countries, but also with private sector. Now, private sector is being fronted, and it is actually very many countries benefiting out of private sector financing. Mm-hmm. It is being fronted as one where most of the finance from climate change will come from. Now, us who have been exposed or used to the aid instruments of financing, we normally sit back and wait and look at the grant angle only. It is high time we started looking at other instruments of financing, understand how they operate, understand the rules of that game, and find ways of tapping into it in a more aggressive way. And we cannot leave it to the negotiators, that's not their responsibility, and we cannot leave it to government alone. We need the private sector to come on board and tap into this financing and help in implementing actions around climate change and, climate mitigation and climate adaptation. Mm-hmm. We need civil society to get involved. We need the media to spread the word. Yes. We need all of us to do something.
Absolutely. Now, as I let you go, Susan, what is lined up for the rest of the days before the COP27 comes to a conclusion? Briefly, tell us what's lined up and how is Uganda doing?
So, for the rest of the week, the ministers are engaging around all these topics. So we have the negotiations going on at that higher level. Uganda negotiates around different blocks, including the Africa Group of Negotiators, the LDC group. Yes. And so we sort of build synergies around that. And I must say, starting yesterday, okay, it was a build-up, but starting yesterday, negotiations are going on till very late in the night. I left the area at 10 p.m. yesterday, but meetings were still going on. And so it is inside the negotiating rooms, it is getting hotter and hotter, and the ministers have to be awake and sharp enough to get us the positions and the interests that we want. Mm. However, outside the negotiating rooms, side events continue to go on, and bilateral meetings as well.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Susan, for your time. And we hope to hear much more from COP27 as it concludes this week. And hopefully, I'm hoping that the Global North can come to an understanding with the Global South in regard to carbon emissions, in regard to climate change, financing and adaptation, but also realize that we are the recipients of these challenges that climate change brings. Now, the impact of climate change is already being felt in various fields, including infrastructure, including business and employment. Life is changing, and this requires sustainable development. In addition to economic development, social security and environmental protection must be ensured to ensure a safe environment for future generations. One of the main goals and objectives of the COP27 conference in Egypt is to phase out fossil fuels and raise funds and strategies for climate vulnerable countries. And we are those countries, and it is very disturbing. Now, I thank you, Susan, for your time. And of course, we keep following up on COP27. But at this particular moment, Miles is already in the studio. And Miles, I have seen Sheba Karungi. She's already on the premises. We are going to speak about Sheba Karungi's journey, and she's one of the leading leading female artists in the country. We wait to see and talk to her in regard to her life's journey as an artist, as a musician, but also as a female. So we do take a break, and when we return, Rush Talk returns.
Happen.